Boost control issues are the most common problem we see when we're tuning turbocharged cars. And when we're tuning EFI, it can be really tempting to try and fix all the problems we come across from the laptop keyboard. But unfortunately, that's not always going to fix these problems, as sometimes we're actually going to have to address more serious mechanical issues. In this video, I'm going to cover the four key problems I see when tuning turbocharged cars. We'll talk about the fixes for them, and we'll also go through a tuning approach that we can apply when tuning turbocharged cars. It's going to minimize the risk of damaging the engine prematurely from an overboost situation. The first problem we come across is probably the more major and is going to actually require quite a bit of work in order to rectify, and this is a mechanical issue. There are a range of issues here. Probably the most common I see though is a problem with wastegate sizing. Simply put, we've got a wastegate that is too small to flow enough exhaust gas in order to control boost. And this can result in the boost starting to spiral out of control as we move higher in the RPM range. We can also see the same problem though, even with a properly sized wastegate, if the wastegate isn't taken off the exhaust manifold in a way that promotes exhaust gas flow. You see, exhaust gas is kind of lazy. It doesn't really like to change direction. So we take the wastegate off the collector of the turbo manifold in a way where the exhaust gas has to kind of go back on itself and turn through 180 degrees. It's just going to say, no way, I'm heading straight out the turbo. And again, we see that exponential growth in our boost as we move further through the rev range. This is going to require either a larger wastegate or fabrication changes to the exhaust manifold in order to promote good exhaust gas flow. The second problem we see, and this is one that really frustrates me because it's so easy to fix, and this is boost control plumbing issues. Now, I get it on face value, it can seem a little bit confusing. We've got these generic three-port solenoids that just about everyone uses. The way these get plumbed will differ depending whether we're dealing with a factory-style turbo with an internal wastegate or an external wastegate. So there are a few peculiarities here, but really, at the end of the day, read the manual. The manual will tell you how to plumb these correctly. So this is really one where there's absolutely no excuses. Usually this just comes down to laziness. When I'm tuning a turbocharged car that's maybe been built by the owner or built by another workshop, I probably see these boost control plumbing issues in 4 out of 5 cars. So this is a really prevalent issue, but again, one that's super easy to fix. The third issue we see, which is a little less common, and this is simple boost control setup inside of our ECU. Basically not having the parameters in place to correctly control boost. This could be as simple as not running the boost control solenoid at the correct duty cycle. Usually we find that somewhere between about 20 and 30 hertz works really well. Or for that matter, just having numbers in our wastegate duty cycle table that are way too high to start with, and this can result, understandably, in overboost or more boost than we really want. The fourth issue, and the one that's actually prompted this video because we've faced this exact issue with the FDRX7 behind me, is a component failure. Now, obviously, there's a wide range of potential component failures. The one that I see reasonably regularly is a problem with the diaphragm and wastegate, whereby the wastegate simply isn't going to open, and of course, we end up with an overboost situation. In the case of this FDRX7, we've actually got one of the plastic pipes or hoses that runs to the wastegate is actually melted through due to the heat. This is a really common issue we see, not just with plastic plumbing, but with any of the common materials we use for plumbing up boost control systems. Obviously, there's a lot of heat being generated around the turbo and the wastegate, so we want to make sure that we are routing our plumbing in a way that avoids that heat. And if we can't avoid all of the heat, then using a heat protection or sheathing over our boost control lines is really, really important. No one wants to have a line fail and an overboost situation that could potentially damage an expensive engine. Now that we've dealt with the common problems, and I should say that while these are the most common problems that I see, it's certainly not the only problems you're likely to come across. But now we're going to move on to a tuning approach that I use that's going to minimize the chances of doing damage if there is an issue with the boost control system. Obviously, as a tuner, we don't necessarily get to go over every car thoroughly, checking out every single component. It's just not possible. So there has to be some assumption that the car has been put together correctly. Given that I've already mentioned the problems that I see so frequently with the plumbing of boost controlled systems, this is one element that I do generally check, but we'll get to that in a moment. To start with, irrespective of the ECU that you're dealing with, we always want to make sure that we've set up an appropriate boost cut. This is kind of a safety backstop in case we do strike a problem with that boost rises uncontrollably. We're going to want to set that boost cut somewhere above the wastegate spring pressure so that if everything is working correctly, we're not necessarily going to hit it. But it's there just in case that boost starts to escalate uncontrollably. Next, we want to disable any electronic control. Why we're doing this is we want to be able to test the mechanical boost control system, basically seeing how well the wastegate on its own with no electronic intervention is able to control boost. There's a variety of reasons why we do this. First of all, it is going to prove that the system is mechanically capable of controlling boost, essentially highlighting any of those other issues that I've already talked about. So it's going to give us a good sense of how good our boost control is likely to be once we do enable electronic control. What I'm getting at here is that if our boost is oscillating or rising uncontrollably or dropping off excessively at higher RPM, then there's a limit to what we can achieve using electronic boost control. And it's a good sanity check here just to have an understanding of what we might be able to achieve. Essentially, if we are getting one of these situations I just mentioned, it's unlikely that we're going to be able to get perfect, smooth, flat boost control using our electronic solenoid. Disabling the boost control can be done in a number of ways. First of all, we can disable the boost control solenoid output from the ECU. Alternatively, we could zero the wastegate duty cycle table. However, this does come into the fact that we need to consider whether the output from the duty cycle is normal or inverted, as that can end up giving us maximum boost when we're actually asking for essentially nothing from the duty cycle table. So that does need to be treated a little bit carefully. Another easy option is just to physically unplug the boost control solenoid, and that should disable the electronic control, reverting us to wastegate spring pressure control. At this point, we should be ready to start performing some dyno runs, and at least to start with, for our first one or two runs, we want to be super vigilant watching that boost like a fork as we go through our first ramp run. We want to be ready to clutch in and get out of the throttle the second we start to see that boost doing something that we're not comfortable with. Now, another trick here is that we don't necessarily need to ramp the engine all the way through to the red line on our first run. There's absolutely no reason that we can't back out at 4 or 5,000 RPM once the engine's up on boost and we start to see what the boost is doing. So particularly if you're new to tuning, I would absolutely recommend this technique. Don't try and go all the way through the red line, just creep on up on it in maybe 500 to 1,000 RPM increments. And each time you're going to be able to see a little bit more of what the boost is doing, giving you that confidence that it is in fact under control. Now that we know that the mechanical system is working and it's actually able to control boost, now's the time to start adding in that electronic control. Here we want to enable the system, zero out the wastegate duty cycle table if we haven't already done this, and again, just test and confirm that we're still getting the same results we saw with no electronic control at all. From here, it's a case of creeping up on our boost targets slowly. So for example, on my first run with electronic control, I'd probably be adding maybe 5 or 10% to the duty cycle table and just seeing what sort of result that gives me. It's a reasonably small increase. Maybe that's going to give us 10 to 20 kPa of boost increase, and that's not going to be a substantial change. So it's nice and safe. It's all about creeping up on our boost targets nice and slowly with iterative changes. And speaking of iterative changes, this brings me to my last point. The process of tuning a turbocharged car is exactly that. It's iterative. What we want to do is dial in our fuel and our ignition timing at our base wastegate spring pressure level. From here, as we add electronic control and raise the boost, we're basically going around in circles. We're going to increase the boost. That's going to affect the airflow through the engine, which will in turn affect the requirements for fuel and ignition. So each time we creep up the boost, we're going to need to alter or optimize our fuel and ignition before going ahead and adding more boost. Now, what we will see in our fuel and ignition tables, though, is a bit of a trend starting to develop. And when we see this trend of perhaps every 20 kPa of boost increase, maybe we see that we're needing to pull out about 2 degrees of ignition timing. Once we see these trends, we can start applying these ahead. And this means that when we do increase the boost into these untuned areas, we're going to find that our fuel and ignition timing should be very close to ballpark already, meaning that A, we're very safe, and B, it's actually reducing our tuning time. So that wraps up our boost control troubleshooting guide. If you apply what we've talked about in this video, you're going to be in a much better place when it comes to tuning turbocharged cars, and you're not going to be tripped up by these common issues. If you do want to learn more, you can check out our boost control tuning course. We'll put a link in the description.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.